Mini Chapter 63. Dad shocked in the motel by the vacant lot. Dad's hammering on the motel room door peters out. Continuing to hammer may bring rescue. However, it would also bring attention, and peering with renewed horror and confusion at the pig's ribcage hanging from the ceiling, he has an instinct that attention is something he'd be better off avoiding in the context of this room in its current state. He therefore redoubles his hunt for any kind of key, while the bag of blood keeps turning in mid-air in the soft glow and heat from the pair of altar candles on either side below. He starts to see a key lying in the half-open drawer of a formica-topped chest. He grabs it, rushes to the window bars and tries it. Yes! He slides the bars aside, opens the window, clambers up to the sill, squeezes through, lands on the walkway and peers right and left over the low railings in front of him. There's no one in sight. He scoots along to the steps, tiptoes down, trots around the corner and across the street to his car, starts it up, does a U-turn and drives away up 99th the way he came, hoping no one is looking through the motel office window to make a note of his license plate number. Once around the block, he turns back onto Vermont from Century and presses grimly on down four more blocks until the motel by the vacant lot appears ahead on the right. Sensing unexpected activity there, he sweeps around the corner of 104th, halts under a lone expansive palm, and stares in growing indignation across the street. In the middle of the vacant lot itself, at the spot he has earmarked for his righteous gun cockpit, the creepy charisma of the infernal blonde man is unmistakable, waving straight at Dud right now with that unholy twinkling humour and menace in his eyes, so sharp even from this far across the street. Just as if Dud has been awaited like a guest of honour who is late for a banquet. He jumps out of the car and strides across to the railing that contains the vacant lot, several of whose bars have been bent away to either side, leaving a hole large enough for a person. Dud climbs through, breathing hard in rage, and thunders across the short stretch of waste ground towards Amber. In the middle of the lot, just where the cockpit will be, Amber is tipping fresh concrete out of a wheelbarrow into a foundation trench that's already half filled with the stuff. Sticking up obscenely from the heavy wet gleam of fresh concrete, a random array of human hands, feet and heads are embedded up and down the trench, lit in yellow from the single lamppost on the side street. So shocked is Dad, as he stoops to verify these half-buried body parts are indeed humans rather than dummies, that he fails to notice Amber has slipped away from the trench and is climbing out through the gap in the railings onto the pavement. Not until Amber has turned around, bent the railings back to their imprisoning verticality, stepped across the street and reached into Dad's car to sound the horn, does Dad wheel around at that familiar sound. In doing so, he catches Amber's and Jamie's murderously affectionate wave at him, with just the fingers of Amber's one hand, as if waving to a baby, while those eyes' fluid humour cuts sharp through the dusk into Dad with contempt. Seconds later, the blonde beast has slipped away into the shadows of the evening. As Dad runs to the railings and tries in vain to bend them back outwards to allow him through, a scattering of camera flashes pop among the onlookers.